depend on our imaginative understanding of what caused what to happen in someone's mind. And suppose you have a court case. Suppose one person killed another. Everybody agrees he hated the guy. But it's also true that the guy he killed was attacking him. So then the question is, there are two motives for this killing. One is, let's say, revenge. The other is self-defense. Everybody agrees that the person who did the killing had both these motives. Right? That's not a completely fanciful case. Yeah, that kind of thing happens. So then the issue before the court is, which was the motive that caused him to act? Not which motive did he have, because everybody agrees he had both motives. The issue that the jury or the judge are being called on to settle is, which motive made him act? And that's something that the jury or the judge or whoever establishes by imaginative reasoning. They try and get the picture as to what was going on. They try and we were discussing this in a seminar where someone who works who spent many years working in the criminal law said, "Look, I can tell you exactly what happens in this kind of case. The counsel for the defense says to the defendant, so this huge guy was coming at you with a knife, right? So what could you do? And the counsel for the prosecution says, is it not true that you weigh 100 pounds more than the deceased and that it was actually just a tiny little knife? It wasn't a big knife at all. And what they do is they try to steer the imaginative understanding of the court one way or another to seeing which motive was the one out of which the action grew, right? And as I say, this is entirely practical. This is really whether someone dies, whether someone is executed, may hinge on that causal judgment there, made in the basis of imaginative understanding. Yeah? So this is really practical. I mean, this is not just some speculation. This is the way things work. So imaginative reason is something that we use, and we use it every day. We don't just use it to in these dramatic court cases. Suppose that you and I have had a minor argument, and then we're both in a crowded elevator, and you stand right on my toe. What I make of that will depend a lot on whether I think it was a row that caused you to stand in my toe. Right? I will use my imaginative reasoning there in just the same way to figure out what was going on. And that's really going to matter for my future, I promise you. I bear grudges. That will really matter for my future relationship with you. Right? So just watch it. That's all. But you see, well, actually, seriously, you see what I mean? This kind of thing matters in a small way every day in everybody's life. So imaginative and scientific reasoning can be held to have a similarly licensed authority to declare what's real, to tell you what's going on in the world around you. They are both identifying the causally significant factors in our surroundings. And we use them both to get knowledge of what's making what happen around us. So that's a general line of thought that I want to test out in the next few classes. So I said general causation and singular causation. This is a really, the first time I heard this, it sounded fantastically technical. It's a very intuitive distinction. General causation is when people say things like smoking causes cancer. That's to say this type of thing, smoking, causes that type of thing, cancer. Aspirin prevents headaches. Excess sugar, I don't know, what does excess sugar cause? Obesity, right? These general things that we get particularly about our health the whole time, that's general causation. In contrast, your singular causation, which is when one event causing another. So it's one thing to say that smoking causes cancer. It's another thing to say Sally smokes. Smoking causes cancer, and Sally got cancer. After all, it could be that smoking causes cancer, and that Sally smokes, and that Sally got cancer, but not that Sally's smoking caused Sally's cancer. Was that too fast? Should I do that again? You want that again? Put up your hand if you want that again. Wow, okay. It's good, isn't it? Okay, you can be raising a question, did Sally's smoking cause Sally's cancer? If, for example, you are a relative of Sally's, or if you are Sally, wondering if you should raise a case against the drug companies, I mean against the cigarette companies, then what you want to know is, was it the cigarette smoking, my cigarette smoking, that caused this particular cancer? You see what I mean? When BP, when there was that huge oil spill in the Gulf, people said, okay, what caused this oil spill? They didn't want to know some general thing like bad management of oil drilling equipment causes oil leaks. They didn't want to know that. They wanted to know what caused this particular leak. You see what I mean? So here what you're asking is, did Sally's smoking cause her cancer? And what I was saying was, it doesn't answer that to be told smoking causes cancer and Sally smoked. Because after all, something else might have been the cause of her cancer. How about that? Having said that this was very simple and intuitive and not technical, I don't seem to be explaining it. No. Put up your hand if that's plain as day. Okay, and if you'd like me to do that one more time? Okay, twice is enough? Okay, maybe I'll do it again at the end. Okay, so general causation is a relation between variables. So a variable is something like age or income, something that has particular values, like 3 years old, 73 years old, whatever. Income, $10,000 a year, $100,000 a year, $1 million a year, whatever. Yeah? So a variable is something that takes on different values. And when you say smoking, what you mean is something like, you can smoke to different levels, and you can get cancer. There can be different probabilities of you getting cancer. And the amount you smoke is correlated with the probability of you getting cancer. You see what I mean? Yeah. So you're talking about a relation there between variables, the variables smoking and cancer. Or if you say how early you go to bed causes your health and happiness, right? There's two variables, how early and level of health, level of happiness. Yep. That's general causation. Singular causation is a relation between particular events. Okay? Happy with that? Okay, I know you you may be able to see my point, but I know the point of my point is not yet clear, but that will emerge. Okay. So one thing that always strikes me is that you can always know, you can know about general causation without knowing anything about singular causation. In the general problem, people always say correlation does not imply causation. So you find a correlation between people taking some drug therapy and recovery from an illness. Right? That happens. You find a correlation between taking the drug and whether you recover from the illness. The people who do take the drug, let's suppose, are more likely to recover from the illness than the people that don't. Would that establish a causal connection? Would that establish that taking the drug causes the thing? Why not? Anyone? Yes? The people who are taking the drug could just inherently be healthier. You have to control for different variables. Okay, very good. Yeah, yeah. Is that what you were thinking too? Perfect, yeah. I mean, there's a really dramatic example of this with hormone replacement therapy, where my understanding of this is that there was a good correlation between hormone replacement therapy and beneficial effects in health. And so this huge study was started across the US, where people were randomly partitioned into groups, some taking hormone replacement therapy, some not. And the whole thing had to be halted halfway through
when it became clear that the therapy was damaging people. And the natural diagnosis is something like this, that there's some third factor. People taking the drug, people taking the therapy, are the people who tend to look after themselves, the people who tend to be careful about their diet, who tend to take exercise, all that kind of thing. And the people who don't are less likely to be doing that. So that factor, how well you took care of yourself, is actually what's causing the correlation. It's making you take the drug, and it's making you get better. So there's a correlation, but there isn't a cause. So what you do in a randomized controlled trial is you put everyone into two groups, and you randomly assign them. You come from outside. An experimenter puts the whole population into two big bins, as it were. And you randomly allocate people to one bin or to another. And then you come from outside the system and seize control of the level of drug in everybody's blood. You make sure that the people in this bin are all getting a particular quantity of the drug. You make sure that the people in this bin are not getting the drug. And then, under those conditions, if there's a correlation between getting the drug and recovery, that can only mean that there's a causal connection between the drug and recovery. Yeah, because that's what you mean when you say controlled. There couldn't be any other systematic background factor here that was responsible for a systematic difference between your two cohorts. That plain as day? So that's causation. That's what causation is. That's what general causation is. Now, the thing about that is, when you find, put up your hand if that's perfectly clear what I just said. Okay? And if it's clear but not perfectly, no, if you don't quite get something in what I said, yeah? Aha. Very good. Okay. So what you're doing here, suppose you have a drug trial taking place, like this is actually an ongoing thing, tamoxifen and breast cancer. They're a huge study, tens of thousands of subjects across five continents are in a big trial to find out, does tamoxifen really prevent breast cancer? Yeah. So you're doing that study, you look at your data for thousands of subjects, and you say, okay, it is or it isn't. But do you need to know of any particular subject whether their taking tamoxifen was what prevented them from getting breast cancer? Well, I think you clearly don't. Yeah? You can find out about the general causation without finding out about the singular causation. You can find out that smoking causes cancer by doing a big study. You don't need to know of any particular person, Sally, whether or not her smoking caused her to get cancer. All you're looking at are the data from those big bins of people without knowing anything about what went on with any one of them, right? I don't see why you would need that. I don't see why you need any specific examples first. That's what I'm saying. You don't need to know of any particular case whether their smoking caused their cancer. You just put 1,000 people in those two bins. Yeah. And if you get these systematic effects, then you can draw the conclusion without knowing for anyone what went on with them. Yep.